You are Master Assassin Fennec Shand of the Midrim.
I take it I'm worth more alive, huh?
You are.
I'll pay double my bounty.
I don't want money.
Who are you?
I am Boba Fett.
Boba is dead.
I was.
Greetings once again, Bucketheads. Mevar Tigar. Welcome to the 132nd Book of Boba Fett dissecting and discussing episode of MandoVision. Nargai Tom, and thank you so much for checking out this small, independent Star Wars podcast. Remember, the best way to find us, is on social media. It's at Mando_Vision, Twitter, and Instagram. You can email the show, mandovisiontom@gmail.com. Make sure you are liking, subscribing, following, and sharing the show with all the other Mandalorians in your covert. And hey, if you're enjoying the show and you have a chance, 5-star reviews, insanely helpful way for us to grow the show, get new listeners to join our covert, and again, Mandalorians all, vode on, right? Let's do this. All right, so yeah, I've been promising this for a little while now. We're going to convene with our good friend Regan from the Come On Is So Good podcast. He is a big Star Wars fan, just like all the rest of us are. He is my vode, if you will. We have sat around and conversed and discussed not just Star Wars, but Boba Fett in particular, for untold hours. I mean, so many hours of our lives have been discussing Star Wars, and particularly Boba Fett. So I thought it was appropriate to bring him on board. And kind of get into the series by and large, like as a whole, and kind of talk about the highs and the lows of the series, what we liked, what we didn't, and if they're going to do another season, what would we like to see them do next, and where can they take Boba from here, I guess is where I want to go with things. So it's going to be an interesting conversation. A little bit of a heads up, I haven't had guests on this podcast very frequently other than my brother, but in my other podcasts that I have done not for Star Wars. I don't put any restrictions on my guests. If they would like to use colorful language, that they are more than welcome to do so. So I want to give a little heads up. There may be some explicit language in this episode. Ray and I can get a little carried away. We can get a little boisterous and start working blue a little bit. So apologies in advance for the language. If you have little ones in the car with you or nearby, maybe make sure you have the headphones on for this one, just in case. Just in case. We will try our best, though. At least I will. I can't promise anything from my good friend. All right, so let's go ahead. Let's link up with Regan and get into it. Like I said, I got a bunch of questions lined up to talk to Regan. But the nice part about this is it's going to be a conversation. It's going to be a discussion. So we could go all over the place. And because Regan and I have such a history together and our love for Star Wars is right on top of our hearts. This could get really, really fun, really, really interesting, but there could be a lot of side tangents about other avenues and other aspects of Star Wars. So it's going to be a real blast. And I'll make sure I'm going to have Regan give you all the particulars. If you enjoy his antics and you want to check him out, with his brothers on the podcast that they do, I'll make sure that he includes all that good stuff for you all. And all right. You know what that means? It's that time. Strap on your buckets. Let's go.
What's next for you?
I'm gonna find my armor. Then I'm gonna kill that bloated pig who double-crossed me. Take his throne.
You wanna head a Gatra?
Why not?
You're a hunter.
I'm tired of working for idiots who are gonna get me killed.
All right, joining me all the way from Maryland, my good friend, my vode, Regan from the Come On It's So Good podcast. How are you doing, my friend? Welcome to MandoVision, your first time on this particular podcast.
I'm so excited to be on this show, and I'm a little annoyed because I did Google just so I would remember what brother was in Mando, and you just stole it from me. So I don't know if we're brothers now.
Whoa!
I was like, he'll be so happy that I kind of remembered this.
I thought you'd be happy that I remembered it.
I did. I am. See, I like how we're both on the same wavelength. Nirvad.
For the people who are new to your wonderful dulcet tones, why don't you tell the good people about your podcast? Come On, It's Still Good.
I'm one of three hosts of Come On, It's Still Good, which is a podcast where we watch retro movies and some new television shows occasionally. And we talk about if they're good or bad. And usually I'm right and my brothers are wrong if they don't agree with me.
Are you still the undefeated champion?
Oh, always. See, always undefeated.
I'm warning you about that. You're becoming Goldberg.
I don't bury people. I'll fight Chris Jericho.
He's just facing jobbers at this point. Come on.
Well, that's what happens when you just lay waste to the field of contenders.
Well,
I have to wait for new rivals to appear.
Well, I appreciate you coming on, hanging out with us. You know, this was a big week as far as Star Wars goes, in that the conclusion of the Book of Boba Fett happened this past week. What were sort of your feelings on the show as a whole?
I mean, your fans on the MandoVision might not know. I am a huge fan of Boba Fett.
Oh, I told him in the intro. Right. Don't worry.
Oh, okay. I've named my dog. I have 6 busts and pictures of Boba Fett in the room I am in right now.
And he's in various states of undress in each one.
Yeah. I mean, wait, no, this is a clean podcast. I can't get crazy on it.
I warn people that you might get crazy on it.
No. I'll try and keep my stuff together. But big fan of the Fett.
Yes, indeed.
Even though I've always been more of a Star Wars guy.
You and I have spent so many hours talking about Star Wars in general, but Boba Fett in particular.
Yes.
That this show kind of coming about. I mean, his return in The Mandalorian Season 2 was one of those, like, oh my God, I have to text Regan right now kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like, Did you watch the show?
Yeah, I imagine it's a lot like you see your first, like, sunrise ever, and it's just amazing. And my wife didn't get why I kept watching that episode over and over again. And I've been waiting 20 years to see more Boba Fett.
Mm-hmm.
But besides him as a child in the prequels.
Okay, right. So yeah, that probably technically even longer than really.
Yeah, I'm trying to.
83. I mean,
outside of like books.
Yeah.
That was my only window into Boba Fett, of him shaving in his helmet.
And he had that special like straw that would fold out so he didn't have to take his own enough to drink. He's just consuming protein shakes like a champ.
Yeah. I mean, did it bother you that he kept taking his helmet off in the Book of Boba Fett because you have that old EU in you?
You know, honestly, a little bit. I tried so hard to like separate myself from that old EU, but the expanded universe it's in my blood.
It's hard to get rid of it when he's taking his mask off every 30 seconds. I know that Boba Fett is no longer. And I'll get used to it.
Yeah, and that's sort of how I came to be about it as well, especially because I think it's Boba in this iteration is supposed to kind of counter Din Djarin's Mandalorian, right? Like, who always has it on. So you couldn't really have two characters who always had it on, right?
I love people in the helmet. Everyone can be wearing the helmet. Like, get Bo-Katan in here. Get Sasha Banks to come back in. I don't remember what her character's name is.
Just keep them all in helmets, though.
Yeah, all helmets all day. They're all different colors, and they have like designs on them. You can figure it out.
No, I'm all for it, but it doesn't feel like that's the way that Hollywood likes to do things. They're like, oh,
well, no, especially when you're paying these actors so much money. They're like, we got to see how beautiful all these people are.
Yeah, I'm super curious. I suspect that like Pedro Pascal didn't set one foot on the set for Book of Boba Fett at all. Like, I'm pretty sure that was all Brendan Wayne.
Oh yeah. I can't see why he would have.
No, just like do your ADR from home or whatever when you got some free time. Because he's doing that, what, The Last of Us adaptation that's going on right now?
Yeah, that's why I was like, he's doing something big, right?
Yeah, like he's a busy guy this year. So overall, though, you were happy with the show?
Oh, yes. Like it would have taken a lot for me not to like a show that's called Book of Boba.
Mm-hmm.
And was it slow at points? Sure. And I know a lot of people aren't crazy about the Sand People or the Tusken Raider stuff. I'm fine with it. It was interesting.
I really liked episode 2 where he's with the Tusken.
That's the train?
That's the train one, yeah.
Yeah, the train stuff's cool. I really like the pikes in this.
Mm-hmm.
I thought they were interesting. Like, do more with the pikes. They're fun.
Yeah, they're great villains from the Clone Wars, and we've got to see a bit more of them in Solo, you know, because they're running the spice mines on Kessel.
Mm-hmm. These pikes look cooler than the ones in Solo, I thought.
I thought so, too, actually.
Like, in Solo, they're just kind of, I don't know, there's a lot going on in that spice mine.
In that sequence, so,
there's robots running around, there's Wookiee. It's a very busy scene.
Yeah. Yeah, I think people know my opinion on the show. Like, I, by and large, I liked it. I enjoyed it. But yeah, there's highs and lows with it for sure. There are things that I was like, oh, that's an interesting choice they made there. Like, and I guess it kind of brings me to my next question for you. Do you sort of understand where Boba's coming from with it wanting to be like the next crime lord of Tatooine?
I don't think he wants to be a crime. I think he's going to end up being a sheriff or something, like a kind of Quantum Leap, like righting the wrongs mm-hmm. that he did in a previous life. I think that's kind of like he's fighting for the underdog.
See, this is some of the stuff I wanted to ask you. Like, I got a bunch of questions along this line because I sort of wondered the same thing. Like, it's like he wants to kind of take over Jabba's territories, and he's willing to like barter, make these deals with the other crime families that are involved, like the Aqualition and the Kletuins and the Trandoshans.
Yeah.
But he doesn't seem to have any interest in like the spice trade or any of the stuff that Jabba was into. So I'm sort of like trying to figure out what he's like, what kind of family is he trying to run here? Like, how are they going to make profit?
I think just protection.
So it's just like, yeah. So it's just a protection scheme.
That's what I think.
Well, not scheme necessarily, but.
But I mean, racket.
Yeah. But well, since he's now eliminated all of his competition, like who's he protecting
him
from?
He promised to get rid of spice.
Yeah.
So the Freetown people would fight.
Well, did he promise to keep spice out of Freetown?
No, because remember how mad Finnick was when she's like, "That's a lot of money."
Yeah.
So I think out of Mos Espa also.
Okay. Yeah, I was sort of unclear on his stance on spice. And if he wanted to control the spice trade on Tatooine, or if he considers it like Tatooine's natural resource, so it must be protected. It sort of seemed to be what he was doing.
I don't think he likes the spice.
Yeah.
Because, you know, to harvest it, you have to, you know, kill Tuskens.
Yeah.
He's not down with that.
No, and you're kind of like strip mining the planet, right?
Yeah, you're taking the one thing from the planet.
Mm-hmm.
You're hurting a bunch of people. Plus, spice apparently super bad for you, and it kills you. I know it's like a kid show,
yeah,
or it's a family friendly show,
right? Drugs
so
are bad.
So they can't show somebody like scratching themselves.
Yeah,
we don't know the effects of spice on
a Disney Plus show.
I mean, I can't wait for the Wire version of Star Wars. It's gonna be a good show.
You know, that's I know, not to throw it back to the EU, but that the extended universe stuff, but that was always kind of one of the fun elements, was like they kind of got darker in those because there was no like oversight. They're like,
you could do whatever you want in some
like,
books.
No one's making more Star Wars, we can do whatever we want.
Yeah, as long as you don't like, you know, make a clone of Luke Skywalker. No, don't do that.
Oh yeah, there's a couple rules, but not too many. No. Can't bring Obi-Wan back to life, can't bring the Emperor or Darth Vader back to life. Though someone broke one of those rules. We won't say who.
They brought the Emperor back?
It was in a movie.
I thought you meant in the EU.
Well,
like I was trying to think of an EU book.
There should be some hard and fast rules, no matter what period it is.
Oh, true. Yeah. Wait in 10 years when they bring Vader back, or in Ahsoka. You know, the Ahsoka show. She's gonna, you know, find his ashes on Endor and then take him to some dark planet and reincarnate him.
All right. So, okay, you're already sort of answering a bunch of questions all at the same time, which is great because. Because, yeah, I'm still a little confused on what he's trying to accomplish on Tatooine.
I'm also very confused because that's the only – because he doesn't want to run – you know, he's not a bounty hunter anymore. He's very – the whole time he's like, you know, I want to run things.
Yeah, he's like, I'm done. I was ready to walk away. Now, that's what he was thinking when he was living with the Tuskens. He was prepared to leave it all behind. And then they get wiped out and he's like, well, you know what? Bib Fortuna sucks. I can go take his job.
Well, how did he does say that he betrayed him?
Yeah.
How?
Is
that like from a re-release of a book or a comic?
I suspect it might have to do with the War of the Bounty Hunters comic book series that came out right around the same time as this was being it came out before it was just before it was being released on Disney Plus. So maybe they were sort of privy to it. And the sort of like the crux of that story is that Han Solo's carbonite frozen body is stolen from Boba Fett. If memory serves, Bib Fortuna sort of instigated Jabba putting a bounty on him.
Okay. Yeah, I can see how that makes you mad. Who stole it? Cad Bane?
Big spoilers, but it's Kira from Solo.
Oh, she's tricky.
Yeah. She's bringing Crimson Dawn back into play. So Crimson Dawn is like rising up in the comic book series right now.
Okay. See, that's who I thought. On my show, we do recaps, and I thought there was someone behind the mayor because I thought the mayor was too weak to plot against Boba like he was. So I was like, that's definitely Kira, and you know, and that's a way to link them back in and have a bigger bad. But they basically just did that with the Pikes.
With the Pikes, right? And you know, it's so funny. The internet is such a funny place. Because they love to throw everything against the wall to see what will stick, and everyone they all had these theories on who's the real power player, you know, behind what the Pikes are doing or like what's going on in Tatooine, and Kira's name came up a bunch of different times on the internet along with a million other names too at the same time.
But
wrong. I sort of take delight when the internet's wrong though. So
yeah, I mean I like to speculate. I'm a big speculator. I like to throw out crazy guesses, like Namor is going to show up at some point and it's going to be awesome.
One of my favorite bits of Reagan's wild speculation was us standing in line to see a Phantom Menace for the first time, and you're like, you turn to me and you're like, hey, what if Darth Maul is Anakin's father?
Wouldn't that be crazy?
And I, you know, to best of my knowledge, hasn't been disproven, so
that's true.
You still could be.
I mean,
something.
He has died twice before that, but you never know.
Back to the show, though. So,
hey, man, that was like 20 years ago. I make equally dumb predictions today.
I just said that's one of my favorites, though. Because I remember like thinking to myself, I was like, "That's dumb." I was like, "Shit, if he's right, I'm gonna be really pissed." Oh man, and that I was the first one to slip up and curse. Dang it.
Yay.
Oh, Reagan wins.
Undefeated. That's how you do it.
I made a booby. I messed up. So I guess one of the other sort of things I was curious about, your take on. Is Boba Fett a good guy?
Yes. This version of Boba, like I think being in the Sarlacc changed him, and he realized, you know, it's his life of being a simple man in the galaxy, like his father before him, you know, let him down a dark path, and he ended up in the belly of the beast. Well, how did that? Like he set it on fire. How did it live?
Yeah, I guess it didn't hurt that bad. You know,
maybe it has more than one stomach. You think they have more than one stomach?
Those Sarlaccs are pretty big. I'll send you a pretty cool like X-ray of a Sarlacc.
I know it's big, but it's fire.
But
from the inside.
I sort of had the same thought when I was watching that first episode. Was it the first episode they showed that, or the second? First. It was in the first. Because then his role by the Jawas for his armor.
Yeah, it's the first.
Yeah. So
you see the stormtrooper and stuff.
I thought he maybe had killed it, because, you know, you didn't see his tentacles come flailing about for him like I thought they might have. But maybe he's just far enough away from the maw.
I'll say it passed out from the pain, or its version of passing like, oh, out. My God, that hurt. But, it just woke up later and was angry.
Yeah, I mean, perhaps.
They're probably resilient living out in the desert.
You know, I'm not like an intergalactic botanist or something like that, because I think a Sarlacc's technically a plant, so.
Is it?
No, they started as like spores, right? Isn't that what the story with them was?
Oh,
they're like these spores that travel through space and they crash into different planets.
I thought the monster in the asteroid was a spore.
I thought that was a worm.
Is that a space worm?
I thought it was a space worm. You're asking me these questions, and I'm going to have to go on the internet now, but I can't go on the internet now because I'm talking to you.
Yeah, I know. And, they have nothing to do with the Book of Boba at all.
No, I agree with your assertion. I think Boba's near-death experience was this sort of like life-changing moment for him. And he goes from, I want to say he was a bad guy before, right, as a bounty hunter, because, he's –
Yes, he definitely was.
He has his code, but he's still more or less the bad guy. You know, he's working against the good guys. If you're in the employ of the Empire, you're probably, not necessarily one of the good guys. You can't be a good guy working for the Empire, right?
Right. So, okay, just let me flip that for you for a second. Because, Boba's bad. There's a guy, Cad Bane.
Yeah.
Who keeps talking about how bad Boba is.
Mm-hmm.
Cad Bane's also a bad dude.
Cad Bane's also a bad dude.
Who's fighting... Did he fight for the rebellion?
Well, see, I don't know. We don't know much about that period of Cad Bane's existence, right? So it's hard for me to say. I can't really speculate on that. Maybe we'll get more into that in season 2 of The Bad Batch or something. As we kind of lead towards the rebellion. But, Cad Bane's working the majority of the time for the Separatists, for Dooku.
Right.
So I don't know. Maybe Cad Bane's had a change of heart for himself. But again, he's working for the Pikes. He's an enforcer.
Yeah, he's working for
spice
trade.
Runners. Yeah.
So, he's definitely not working for the good guys. And he walks into a town and murders the deputy and critically injures the sheriff.
Yeah.
Scare me like
no,
that.
No. I sort of wondered about Cad Bane's choice of words in that final standoff. Where we're like, oh, he worked for the Empire. He's a murderer. And I was like, well, so are you, dude.
Yeah, yeah.
But maybe
you're not a good guy,
but
ever.
Maybe that's just because he was trying to, demoralize the people who were trying to support him. I'm hey, by the way, this guy's not the good guy you might think he is. Not that, everyone, let's be honest, everyone should know who Boba Fett is, but whatever.
Yeah. Well, yeah, also he was, the most famous bounty hunter, or notorious.
Infamous. More than famous.
Yeah. you're Mr. Disintegration.
Yeah. So now he's kind of he's turned babyface, right? He wants to protect Mos Espa.
You're speaking my language now. oh my God, that's a good heel turn. Yeah. Or a face turn. Face turn.
Yeah, did a face turn. And again, I sort of get it. Again, you've been through that experience in the Sarlacc. You've almost died. Because you were enforcing the will of Jabba the Hutt, who was a bad dude, and he put you in a bad position where you could get hit on the jetpack with a random staff from a blind Han Solo and go careening to your death. So it's not a good look. That makes you rethink things.
Yeah, that death is still – it's even worse now, looking back on, how accidental it was.
Well, it's sort of the interesting part of, the Boba Fett mythology is, if you when you count, what we actually know that's, in canon of him as a bounty hunter, it's those moments from Jedi and Empire, right?
Yeah.
So we know nothing, really. Everything else is made up in our minds, or it's based off, the old EU.
Yeah, it's old comics, it's old book, or the holiday special.
A holiday special, where he's like, hello,
Although,
friend.
That's canon, right?
No, not really. I mean,
okay, it's out of canon. I've heard that it's
Favreau,
canon.
Favreau's
out of...
bringing elements of it into play.
Well, as he should. None of the weird holographic, Wookiee stuff that's in that movie should be canon.
No, I mean, and they've been reintroducing Life Day, obviously, and like they did in the Mandalorian. Yeah. So Life Day's kind of, like, again, elements. It's just like the old EU, how they're slowly kind of weaving some stuff back in, like Thrawn and like Paelian, who they mentioned. You know, some of these characters are.
Do you know how excited when they mentioned name dropped him? I was like, oh my god, I'm lightheaded. It's happening.
Yeah. It's crazy. It's like, yeah, it's all those dreams and conversations we had, you know, 20 years ago. It's ridiculous. Yeah. So I guess what I want to know is, like, you're cool with the turn, right? With him going face.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. 'Cause you can't root for him if he's a villain.
Right.
For an entire show. Like, it's Star Wars. It's about good triumphing, you know, over evil. So you can't have him kidnapping kids and hurting people. He can only hurt, you know, evildoers. He's basically the Punisher now.
but with a family and a big Wookiee, yeah, and those mod kids and Fennec Shand, who I don't let's talk about Fennec for a little bit, because I'm still kind of wondering why she's hanging around, because I think she thought there was gonna be like some money involved in this at some point. There doesn't seem to be that much. He's like, nah, spice, we're not doing that. No.
She seems to get annoyed a lot. She's like, oh, that's a bad decision. Oh, we're not getting any money? Okay.
And then she like runs off and assassinates like 8 dudes. I mean, that's awesome. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah, it's awesome.
But yeah, at various points during the series, it seemed like she was annoyed with him for cutting off these avenues of income.
Yeah.
And I was like, why is she sticking around? Or is she just kind of slower to the face turn where she's like, I guess we're going to do this? Okay.
Yeah, I guess she would be classified as like neutral evil.
That's sort of what I was thinking. Yeah, I was trying to think of it in like role-playing games terms, and I think neutral evil is kind of where she's falling right now.
Yeah.
But I mean,
like if you.
But I mean, again, when we see her in the Bad Batch, you know, she's much more neutral good because she's trying to help Omega. You know, she's looking for the.
But she's still only doing it for money.
Right, but she's not working for the Separatists or the Empires to find for the Empires. Like, it's plural. The Empire.
She could work for another empire that we don't know about, the Secret Empire.
Ooh, the Secret Empire. That sounds dangerous.
Yeah.
Don't worry. That's actually The Mandalorian Season 3.
The Secret Empire?
Yeah. Run by Admiral Thrawn.
Season 3 is definitely going to be like Clan Wars, where they're going back to Mandalore.
No, dude, we can speculate about that later.
Mm-hmm. Oh, look at him shutting me down.
No, I think you're... I've talked about that on the show. What are you doing?
That was my idea first. You heard it here. Anytime he says it in a future Mando vision, I just want y'all to know he got it from me. Yeah, I hope she doesn't turn on him and go back to her evil ways. Like, I'm hoping that she's also had enough of you know, mercenary work. Because he's trying to give her a second chance and show her another way. I don't think he really knows what it is. He just knows what he's been doing before doesn't work.
Right. And he wants to go away from bounty hunting because it's a insanely dangerous occupation.
Yeah.
No, I agree with that. I wish I sort of have. I mean, I get it. The show's. So what I'm going to say is going to be a whole thing. The show's called The Book of Boba Fett, right? But early on, I had said, like, oh, wouldn't it be neat if we also got, like, some cool Fennec Shand flashbacks to kind of get to know that character a little bit better, get to explore that character a little bit more. And then I would counter that by saying, like, but I get it. It's The Book of Boba Fett. And then a week later, it became The Mandalorian 2.5.
The Mandalorian's music kept coming on every 30 seconds after that.
Oh my gosh. At the end of episode 4, when she's like, you know, says like, I know where to get some help, or I know where to get some muscle. And like, you hear the notes and you're just like, oh, come on. Oh, come on.
Did she know he was in town before that? Or did he happen to land on Tatooine? And she's like, you know, if you got credits, I can find him. Or is he already there?
I think she might have a people in Mos Eisley keeping, you know, contacts and sources.
Like, so she got word that she might know that he's looking to replace the Razor Crest at that point, and he's put an order in.
Yeah, she's got ears to the ground somewhere.
So you know, she can get word through her.
Yeah, exactly.
Through Pelly.
Yeah, that's sort of what I think was going on there. I think Fennec has this vast network of resources that we haven't really seen just yet, because the you know, again, the show's not that focused on her. I kind of wish it would spend a little bit more time with her.
Yeah, me too. She's an interesting character that we don't know a lot about, mm-hmm. even though she's been in the Bad Batch and things like that, which is cool. But she's always the bad of that week. You know, she's trying to grab Omega or protect Omega.
Right. Yeah, I guess it's sort of like one of my regrets with the show is, like, I wish they had spent a little bit more time on Fennec, because I think that would have been neat.
Yeah.
It's a great...
I think where they could have squeezed it in.
Well, I mean, again, I didn't know they were going to shift to, you know, Mandalorian for two episodes.
Yeah.
Because that probably could have been a nice spot, but they obviously had a plan to kind of get the Mandalorian reset so that you could go into season three without having to do these particular things. You're like, let's just kind of clear the decks now.
So yeah, let's get Grogu back to him.
Right.
So we don't have to waste an episode with that. I mean, waste is the wrong word, but you know. Which, I mean, that episode's great.
No, it's phenomenal. Did it bother you in one way or another that they did sort of diverge from Boba Fett's story to go back to Din?
Well, no, because I love Din as well.
Exactly.
Like, you put on the best car and we're best friends. So
I mean, it does start with BES.
Yeah, that's right. But that was fine. I enjoyed, like, he went back to bounty hunting to make ends meet, or just try to, you know, after he had this two-season adventure, he tried to go back to his old life, and he can't.
Mm-hmm.
He misses Grogu too much. He cuts himself with a lightsaber all the time. It's terrible. His old clan won't take him back in. No. You know, it's hard. You can't go home again is what's going on.
No, for sure. I mean, the episodes are outstanding because they're continuing this character that we've become very attached to mm-hmm. during The Mandalorian. So this is going to be a tough question to ask. But was The Book of Boba Fett kind of a shallow show until they interjected this emotional core by bringing back Din and Grogu and kind of bringing their story into play?
I don't want to say yes.
I don't either.
Like, my fandom is like, don't say yes. But it's quite obvious. Like, before Mando shows up, Boba Fett shoots one thing.
Mm-hmm.
He shoots one of the assassins in episode one or episode two.
When he blows him up with a rocket?
Yeah.
Yeah. That was one.
That's the only time he takes a shot until the final episode.
Mm-hmm.
And it... That's all. That's not the Boba Fett we know. I want to see him fight things and have action.
It's sort of a curious choice. I agree with you. And you know, part of me wonders, and I don't like to get into like the sort of like Disney conspiracy of it all, but like there's a part of me that wonders if it's like, well, Disney doesn't want like the quote unquote heroes to be getting their hands dirty too much with just blasting random dudes.
Din kills people all over the place.
I don't know. But again, they're trying to make this thing into Boba Fett, you're right? They want to make this face turn.
All right, so they're like, he doesn't want... But he's only, you know, he's not killing the Twi'leks or any innocent people. He's only killing, like, the Swoop Gang.
Right.
Drug deal. Like, you know, he's only doing Punisher
work. And people loved it when he killed the Swoop Gang. So I mean, it's like,
even though they're framed,
if you're Disney and your sort of motto is give the people what they want, I mean, Boba Fett shooting dudes is kind of the way to go.
Yeah, and he still do bounty hunting work, but he only takes bounties about, you know, really bad people.
Yeah,
not somebody who ran out on a bill or something. They'll be like, oh, this is a mass murderer.
Well, that's sort of curious. I sort of brought that question up because, again, I didn't know the plan was to go to the Mandalorian in the fifth episode and bring back Din and Grogu and kind of give the show heart that way. So I think it's one of the reasons, because I didn't know that, as I'm watching it week to week, when you get to episode three and the Tusken tribe is just mowed down like mm-hmm. very early in the episode, and you're like, oh, I thought this is where we were going to start getting like those kind of like emotional connections and why Boba's mm-hmm. trying to do what he's going to do. And it's like, oh, all right, we're not doing that. I don't know what's going on in the show anymore. And not in a bad way, necessarily. It just was like, Jon Favreau writes stories in such a unique way.
Yeah.
That I'm like, oh, okay, that's a choice. We're doing that instead. And you just kind of roll with it.
They all get gunned down. He gets out of the back to the droids like, all right, you're all healed, so we don't need to think about those Tusken Raiders ever again.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, go free a Wookiee. Like.
Go free a Wookiee, as they say. I think that's the old adage on Corellia. Go free a Wookiee.
Yeah. Go free a Wookiee. You know, look a Rancor in the face. It'll become your friend.
with yeah, you know, right. you said, yeah, we don't need to go that road. We talked about the Tuskens enough, I think. You were okay with it, but you weren't.
I was okay. It wasn't the best part of the season, mm-hmm. but I enjoyed him learning to fight. But once they were murdered, how they were murdered, with there's zero stakes from it.
Yeah.
That, oh, he's sad about it. You don't know how long time has passed. His friends are murdered. He's like, you know what? I should get my armor and take over a crime syndicate.
Mm-hmm.
Is his reaction to it, I guess?
Yeah.
It was just really nebulous. He doesn't turn himself on a dime over this family that he's made.
No, I'm not surprised that the Tuskens died. I was just surprised how quickly it happened. It really happened, because I thought maybe at a certain point, like after being with this tribe for X amount of time or whatever, then they get, you know, some kind of massacre or whatever. And he's like, oh, I need to become the daimyo to protect the Tuskens.
Yeah.
Sort of made sense to me, but they did not go that route at all. they 180'd me really quickly. And that's fine. I have no problem not being right with my own personal projections on things. Like, that's fine.
Yeah.
Tell me your story. I'm here for it.
I'm in for the ride. Yeah. Are you surprised Cad Bane didn't murder the Tuskens?
Yes.
Yeah, me too.
So
that seems right up his alley, where they're like, oh, we're threatened. We're going to send our number one hitter in.
Once they brought in the Pikes, looking back on it, I really wish they had brought in Cad Bane around the same time. Like after the train heist, or I guess I'll use the word heist, even though it's not necessarily a straight up train robbery, but
yeah,
ultimately it was. But if your closing shot, you know, before or the shot before you have Boba around the fire doing the tribal dance with the Tuskens, is Cad Bane arriving to survey the scene of the carnage?
Broken train. Yeah,
yeah. To me, that's like oh, here we go, and then some episodes kind of getting into that Boba Cad Bane relationship that they only talked about in the last episode.
Yeah, they could do it the same way they introduced Boba in The Mandalorian, where you just hear the footsteps,
mm-hmm.
and you just see, you know, foot in the dirt, and it pans up, and you see the broken out train, and they can pull back, and you see the silhouette with the hat,
yeah.
and the jet, and you'd lose your mind.
Yeah, 1,000%.
And then it'd be the whoa, and then credits would be playing, and you'd be like, was that just Cad Bane? And then they wouldn't talk about it for weeks until he shows up in Freetown.
Well, see, I disagree. I think you should have had him in the show more. I think you should have set up more of an adversarial relationship between the two, and then you could have gotten into like their history more instead of having it be just like exposition during a standoff.
Okay.
That's just my looking back at it.
They're going to go to that in season two, because I don't believe Cat's dead.
No, I don't think Cad Bane's dead either. They focus on that blinking chest light for way too long.
Yeah. Well, I really expected him to be in Boba's back to tank.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I thought that would have been awesome. He's trying to give him a second chance, yeah. like he was given. You know, that's kind of like his thing now. He's like, you were bad. Here's your second chance. If you're going to continue to be bad, I'll kill you again.
I really like that idea, actually.
Yeah.
I would have been into that.
Yeah. So, I mean, maybe it happened. Maybe he has more than one back to tank.
But then the only problem with that scenario is, as much as I like it, is like, then all of a sudden you got like all the cool bad guys in Star Wars turning face at the same time. And you're like, who's left to kind
of
be like,
you could make plenty of new bad guys.
You would think. But can you really name some newer Star Wars bad guys that you really like?
Newer? That aren't like Stormtroopers or Imperials?
Right. Like who's the character from the sequel trilogy? You're like, oh my gosh, I have to know more about that person.
Phasma, because I don't know anything about her.
You don't want to know, trust me. Yeah. I read that book.
I know she has a book. She has a book I haven't read.
Don't bother.
But just from her, you know, not being, or, you know, thrown in a dumpster in the first movie. They're like, don't worry, the second movie, we're going to get into her. You're going to learn more about her. And they're like, just kidding, you're not. But the third movie, that's when you're figuring it out.
So what a, I shouldn't say that, but I was, well, I'll say it and I'll be controversial. What a series of letdowns those sequels were. Just one,
yes, they were.
So much potential. And you're just like, eh, we'll just leave that potential on the table. It's fine.
I mean, the first one is such shiny lights and bright flashing that it confuses you. And you're like, I think I like this.
So, yeah,
and that strobe wears off.
So we just talked about CAD, which is good because that was on my notes, too. I definitely wanted to pick your brain about CAD. I mean, I love seeing him. I was excited with his debut. I know, you know, the Internet, as usual, was in an uproar at first because they didn't like the way he looked. They're like, it wasn't an animated series enough. I thought it was great. I was blown away. I mean, when you just see like the silhouette coming out of the desert.
Ugh.
I
stood up in my house. Like
it did sort of make me chuckle a little bit. It was like, oh, well, good thing Din parked over there and didn't have to walk past him on the way back.
What? Din could have just walked past him and, you know, tipped his cap to him. He's this guy walking into town.
That would
none of my concern.
It's so random.
None of my concern.
I have to ask you about another controversial element to the show. The mods with their sort of souped-up Vespas. Again, probably the most, I would say it's the most hated element of the show.
Yeah.
How did you feel about it? What was your take? Are you more forgiving of it than others? I'm assuming you're like me and probably a little bit more forgiving of it than others.
I'm more forgiving. My main problem with them is they're too clean for Tatooine.
Too clean they're for probably, Tatooine. They have a shirt that says that.
Yeah. I mean, if not, they should be made. Their bikes are so pretty and spotless to live in a desert world.
Yeah.
It made no sense how clean they're. Just make them warm. They could still be the colors. Just, you know, sand them up a little bit. Have, you know, age out the metal so it looks like it would fit in.
Yeah.
So shiny.
It was sort of an element I had never really considered before because when we've been on Tatooine, you know, we've mostly seen like moisture farmers or like Anakin as a slave in the slave quarters and things like that. We've never really have seen like quote unquote Tatooine city kids.
Yeah.
Which I was like, okay, that's interesting. Even more interesting though was the choice to get cybernetic modification. That seemed random, right?
I assume most of them had like accidents or something where their arm was injured.
See, I'd like to know those kind of things though, or if they're like, no, just take my arm and give me this metal one instead. Like that's, I'd like to know more.
I heard Luke Skywalker has a metal hand. Give me a metal hand.
Right. You know, and it's. I mean, they sort of set up the mod shop like the cool Tatooine hipster tattoo parlor.
Yeah.
The Tatooine parlor.
Tattoo on Tatooine.
Ooh! I think we found you a business to start, buddy.
Oh man, it's gonna be good. We're only gonna do mods there, though. They're gonna be the worst mods money can buy.
Everyone just has like iPhone chargers hanging off their limbs,
but they don't work. They're like the broken lightning cable where you gotta wiggle it a little bit, and then you just yell at Apple for still having lightning cables instead of USB.
Or it's even worse because like you put on that Apple charger, but you have a Samsung, and you're like, what the heck?
Gotta change phones. Sorry, man.
Mod's a mod, ain't coming out.
Yeah. Hey, you didn't specify. That's what I had in stock. Come on.
So, I think the one thing that maybe I'm nuts. Let me know if you noticed the same thing I did. I thought one of the criticisms of the mods in the third episode was the chase through Mos Espa, right? That it didn't look great. That you know, it looked kind of slow and choppy and all that stuff. And I can't disagree with that necessarily. But I did think it looked better in the seventh episode. Which tells me they saved the money for the seventh episode.
When it mattered most.
Yeah.
When they were having the most stuff going on. Yeah.
Yeah, I've tried to
tell people. And I thought it looked fine.
I've tried to tell people, it's like, shows have a budget, man. And you got to dole it out. You got X amount of money to do this many shows. Some shows have less budget than others.
Yeah, I mean, this one wasn't even budgeted for 8 episodes.
No, and you had you know, some had short runtime, some had long time. So like, I think there's also like length of time to do these things as well. Because like there was like a 50-minute episode, and then there was like a 30-minute episode. But most of them hung around like the 40-minute range. So there had to be a balance somewhere. But yeah, I mean, look at that final episode. Guy rode a Rancor. That's going to cost some change. You brought in, you know, D.H.
Giant
Luke Skywalker
droids.
In episode 6. That's going to cost some money too. You got to put that money where you need it the most.
Yeah, Rosario Dawson showed up as Ahsoka. Mm-hmm. You got to stroke her a check.
I suppose. I mean, you know, I would do it for free, but that's just me.
You might do it for free the first time. Like, the first one's a buddy-buddy thing. And it's like, oh, you want me to come back?
Well, what are the odds that let
only
me...
Only money.
What are the odds that let me play a fan-favorite character, though? Like, let's be honest. I'd be like a one-hitter, and just they'd be like, all right, you're done. Get out of here. I'm not even cool enough to be like Captain Carson Teva's sidekick.
Yeah, it's they drive by Tashi Station again. You could come out and be like, I love power converters. And then they just keep driving.
I have like a sandwich board sign on that says power converters 2 for $5.
Yeah. Well, they're on sale.
They're on sale,
everybody,
baby.
You got to get to Tashi Station.
It's a sweet deal, dude. You can't find a better deal. It'll be on my sandwich board. You'll see. Yeah, I don't know. I don't have a problem with this. I had more questions about this, about the mods and that whole set of situation. But I was like, whatever. Like Star Wars. Like maybe we'll get into this somewhere down the road. Yeah. Maybe we'll talk about this later on. Like, why are Tatooine kids into modifications? You know,
maybe season 2 of the Bad Batch, they end up on Tatooine and there's a bunch of mod kids running around.
Mm-hmm.
Or mod, you know, different mod kids. I think the years don't add up. Actually, I have no idea when season 2 of The Bad Batch takes place. It could take place 5 years later.
Right. Well, since you're talking about time, let me ask you this question, because one of the things I've wondered about when I'm doing these, especially the early episodes where I'm sort of trying to figure out the timeline, you know, because, you know, they've said that The Mandalorian is roughly 5 years after Return of the Jedi.
Yeah.
So how long was Boba in the Sarlacc pit, or how long was Boba Fett with the Tuskens?
My brothers and I, we've discussed this at great length on and off our podcast. We can't stop talking about it enough.
I'm so curious about it, and I can't settle on it. Like, I suspect he's he must have been in the Sarlacc for a bit.
Yeah, just for we think hours.
Okay,
or maybe a day or two, at the most, and then he gets out.
Well, because he
gets rolled by the Jawas. We think he lived with the Tuskens for years.
That's what I'm thinking too. Which also undermines their demise even more, because you only really spent like the one full episode with them before they're just massacred. And you're like, oh,
yeah,
that stings.
Yeah, because by the time they're killed, he's walking the desert. You don't really know how much time has passed.
Right.
When he finds Finnick.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe he's out by himself for a year.
Another year on his own, something like
just
that.
Just baking in that sun, going crazy.
Hanging out with his bantha.
Yeah, like a bantha.
I was curious about that. And you know, I know that in the Sarlacc, you know, you slowly digest over, you know, 1,000 years or whatever it is. I think it's 1,000, right? Not 10,000.
Yeah.
I think it's 1,000 years. And so I could see him being in there for a bit. But like you said, I mean, how long before, you know, I don't think he could be in there for a year and be like, oh, yeah, wait, I have this flamethrower here. Hang on.
Yeah, I just think he was, you know, unconscious for like a day or in and out of it.
Right.
And it woke up, you know, he had that like real dry mouth and he was like, and he realized where he was. And he was like, oh, I got to get out of here.
Yeah.
And there's just a random Star Trooper in there.
So why does Boba Fett think his armor's in the Sarlacc once he gets his ship back?
I think he was so delirious when he got out of that thing.
I agree with you. I'm asking questions that the internet asked, and I was like, I guess I'll ask Regan that question too.
I mean, it's got to be so hot in that stomach.
It's so
there's two twin sons of Tatooine. It's hot.
It's like a sauna in there.
Yeah, and he's in full Beskar.
Mm-hmm.
It's got to be hot. It had to be like 200 degrees. He was probably cooking inside there, like a air fryer.
Yeah. Yeah, I like that reference actually quite a bit. No, I agree with you. He probably took all of his energy to get out of the Sarlacc. So the last thing he's thinking about as he's crawling through the sand at that point is, you know, like the condition of his armor that his armor's in. Like for all he knows, he's could be, you know, buck naked.
Yeah, he had no idea what was going on, and then, you know, he gets shocked and beat up by a bunch of Jawas. Little jerks.
It's a little... I was a little sad. I was like, oh, man, Boba just got rolled by Jawas. Come on.
Yeah. I mean, I thought the same thing, but I was like, all right, he did just crawl his way out of the Sarlacc. I mean, what are you going to do?
Do you think Boba Fett was kind of powered down in his own show, because when we caught up with him in The Mandalorian, I mean, he was whooping some Stormtrooper booty.
Immediately, yeah. It's one thing that bothered me is he was getting beat up a lot. Like, those assassins come out and start whooping him.
Yeah.
And I was like, don't you have a flamethrower? Like, melt these dudes.
I sort of thought the same thing. I sort of understand Kersantan's attack a little bit more, because apparently he just walked into the palace unseen. Well,
yeah, I mean, that's more on Fennec, if I'm being real.
She just got one of those ring cameras going on the door.
She has one. It's on the back of her sniper rifle. We see it. We saw her camera. Like, she has cameras everywhere. She's a really heavy sleeper, is what we realized.
Or Kersantan's like Drax, and if he moves slow enough, he's invisible.
All right, I believe that. but once he starts punching you with his, electro knuckles, whatever they are.
Yeah.
Is that scream, Boba? Yeah, I'll be like, help, help me.
I'm in my underpants and I'm getting tossed around by a giant Wookiee.
I don't know why this Wookiee hasn't just ripped my arms off.
How much? I'm guessing this is your sort of first experience with Black Kersantan.
Yeah, it absolutely was. I did, after this, go and read a comic that he made a brief appearance in.
Okay.
And I was excited. I was like, I know who that guy is now.
How?
Like,
I was gonna say, when you first saw Kersantan, what was your initial reaction to him?
I thought, oh, cool, another Wookiee. I had no idea his backstory or everything. I was like, obviously he's a badass. Or, shoot.
Ah, we gotcha.
he's a tough guy. just the way he shows up. And I was like, oh, they're going to have a cool fight. And they do, but the kids come and save Boba. And I was like, I guess you got to make the kids look useful.
Right. But at the expense of Fennec looking useful, who doesn't show up till the very end to bring down the Rancor
pit. And puts him in a pit.
Yeah.
Also, the fact that Boba doesn't shoot one of those Hutts in the face.
Yeah.
Really annoyed me.
I mean, this is all part of his different way, right? Like, I'm trying something new.
He shouldn't abide by their rules. You're talking to my guy wrong. You're using the wrong tone talking to Boba like that.
Well, and then I got, like, super curious about the Hutt power structure. Because, obviously, it's significantly weaker after Jabba's death.
I think it's very splintered.
Yeah, but because they seem to have no teeth now. And they're like, oh, the pikes are coming? We're out.
Yeah, that's exactly what I thought. And they're like, have Santo. He can stay. Here's a Rancor. Danny Trejo's with you now, I guess. He might just be in the background somewhere.
Trejo's
drinking
tacos,
blue
baby.
Liquor.
He's making tacos. Trejo's tacos. Come on.
Oh, delicious.
Oh, man. Yeah. I like seeing Danny Trejo in Star Wars. Like, something about that delights me to no end.
It delighted me. I don't trust him. As soon as I saw him, I was like, oh, he's going to double-cross Boba. Like, I don't trust Danny Trejo. He's too famous for the role he's playing. I know it's directed by Robert Rodriguez. It's probably just two buddies wanted to hang out.
Right.
But I was like, I don't quite trust you, Danny Trejo.
That was sort of my thing with the whole show. I kept waiting for, like, betrayal from somebody. Fennec was my prime suspect for a long time.
I know. I didn't like that you kept doing that. Didn't like it at all.
Well, I didn't know Cad Bane was coming into the show. And I was like, oh, we're going to find out Fennec killed the Tuskens. Because, like, she has that one line. It's like, spoof gang, no way. Get out of here.
Yeah.
Because I did it.
Oh, I would have hated that so much. Like, it would have made me so sad. Unless she starts running, like, a counter organization, it still upset me that they were fighting again. He saved her.
No, I it's so interesting to me. I don't have the right word I want to say, other than, like, this show is just very straightforward and very direct. Like, there's not, like, super complex character relationships going on. So, like, betrayal is sort of, like, not in the cards for any of it, which I don't know if that's a positive or a negative for Star Wars shows going forward, because, I mean, obviously it's Star Wars, so it's got to be kind of, like, all ages friendly. But, right. I mean, one of the first things we learn all about betrayal. We grew up on Empire Strikes Back. Looking at you, Lando. Looking at you, buddy.
Look, he had no choice. They showed up right before he did.
It's true.
What is he supposed to do? He had all those people to think about.
Hey, just don't alter the deal, okay?
I know. I mean, pray that he doesn't do it further.
No, you don't want to mess with the Vader deals, all right? He'll alter them. He sees fit. He's like an NFL owner.
Oh. Can't trust him then.
No. So yeah, I don't know. And again, I freely admit that when I play the speculation game, I get myself into trouble.
Yeah, I mean, so do I. I make crazy speculations all the time that don't come true.
Yeah, 1,000%. I think my batting average on speculation is like 0.5.
Oh yeah,
no, it's so low. 0.005, I should say. It's like ridiculously low.
Yeah, no, I look like a Chris Davis batting average.
Yeah, and I actually like being wrong because I like not knowing what's going to happen next. Like that's one of my favorite things. So it works out pretty great. But yeah, I don't know if I just have sort of like this higher. That's not the right word either. Again, I think I'm just expecting the show to be more complex, and maybe I'm just spoiled by the shows that I watch that are like that.
Yeah.
Like I'm like, this isn't
going to be like a True Detective.
Yeah,
or...
this isn't Better Call Saul on Tatooine. Like, we're not doing that. I mean, I'd love that.
Oh, I mean, that Twi'lek guy could definitely be Saul Goodman.
Saul Good, man.
Yeah.
I would lose it. That'd be amazing. But yeah, I mean, that's not what Star Wars is, and I kind of keep forgetting that sometimes. So I set myself up for some of the things that I'm like, oh, that didn't pan out the way I thought it would. But again, I'm still immensely entertained by the show. And so like the people who are detracting against it, like most of the criticisms I completely understand. And I'm like, yeah, I mean, you're not wrong, but I still really, really like the show. So,
right.
You know, can you just be entertained for a little bit here? Can you just not harsh on it and have a good time?
No, I don't get the negative criticism, like right when something comes out, and it was always weird to me, because it's a Star Wars show. Mm-hmm. If you had said 20 years ago that I was going to have not one, but two Mandalorian-centric television shows,
right,
I would have lost my mind. And I'm also getting an Obi-Wan show, an Ahsoka show.
Cassian Andor
show, mm-hmm. which I don't know how good that's going to be. Like,
they've already renewed for season two, so I think it's
all right.
It must be pretty good. Hey,
we've seen how that show ends. So.
True.
That's my problem. I mean, I've seen how the Obi-Wan show ends as well.
I was just going to say that.
If you want to get into it.
I got news for you about Obi-Wan.
It doesn't change. What if you find out it's a synthetic robot that he made? It looks like Obi-Wan.
There's like an Obi-Wan LMD droid running around.
Yeah. He made it look like Sir Alec Guinness. and then Ewan McGregor's going to pop out from a closet after he leaves with Luke on the speeder, and he's like, got him. And then that's where the show picks up.
So.
Just like Ferris Bueller's, they bought it, and then like he starts to do like Donkey Shane and stuff in the shower.
See, I started going to Iron Man 3, where like it's like the Mandarin situation. You know, you get like an actor to play you. You get like
that's,
an actor
that's
to play.
More of a bummer.
You find a guy. You're like, hey, can you be Obi-Wan Kenobi for a little bit?
I mean, they did redeem that character in Shang-Chi.
Heck yeah.
And Trevor was really good in that movie. Maybe I'll go back and watch Iron Man 3 as more of a grown-up adult person. Maybe I'll like it more.
Oh, there you go. My brother,
I mean, I'm not more grown up yet, but, you know, 10 years, anything can happen.
So what do you think the show does for Boba Fett's mythology in general? Like, you think it enhances it, adds to it, or do you think it kind of detracts from it? Because, again, you and I, we grew up with that EU, and Boba Fett was pretty hardcore for a long time in there. But again, this would be on us and our generation.
Yeah.
But what do you think overall?
I've already let it go of the EU. So it can only enhance it because this is, you know, I hate to say it, but this is true canon.
Right.
Because it's live action.
Right.
This will never be stricken, even though they keep threatening to strike things from canon from the movies.
Okay, yeah, but when you say they, you mean like fans on the internet with a Twitter account.
Well, I also mean like Lucasfilm, you know, or Disney has taken things out, but like that's no longer canon. But they won't do it with live action stuff.
It won't happen with like the films or anything.
But,
yeah.
You know, Ewoks aren't canon.
The Ewok films, you mean?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I mean, yes, Ewoks are canon, but the battle for Endor Caravan of Courage are not canon.
Wilford Brimley's not canon? Come on.
Yeah, this should be. Just make them canon. Wicked's awesome.
I don't see what the harm is, but you know, what do I know?
Yeah, it's an adventure for kids. Like, it doesn't hurt anything. It doesn't detract from the Star Wars story.
No, I agree
with you. I'm sorry there's no lightsabers in it, so you guys can't market it. It's the only Star Wars thing without a lightsaber in it.
I 100% agree with you. I think it adds to Boba Fett's mythology. Whether you like it or not is completely subjective and up to you. But the fact of the matter is we got Boba Fett back. He's in play. He's will probably be a part of if not his own show continuing, The Mandalorian moving forward at the very least. You know, hanging around with Din Djarin and doing things.
Yeah.
You know, or at the very least, he's like a fixture on Tatooine now. Because Tatooine seems to be the center of the universe for Star Wars. Now we can go back there and be like, oh, well, this is the guy who's you know, changing things on Tatooine.
Isn't it weird that that's now like the center of the Star Wars universe? Because in Phantom Menace, they're like, this is like a backwater,
right,
nothing planet.
Now we can't get enough of Tatooine nowadays. I mean, like the next show up is Kenobi. Where is it taking place? Tatooine. At least the majority of it. It sounds like there'll be flashbacks to other places and other times, but we'll see.
Oh, I know they've rewritten it because it didn't. He was like helping a child as well.
Yeah, apparently it was too much like the Mandalorian. Yeah, it was too much like the Mandalorian the first time. Yeah, so I mean, again, Tatooine is a fixture. We're never not going away from it, and for better or worse, we are sort of. Again, I don't mean this in a negative way, but we're sort of stuck with the familiar, with what we know. Because Disney wants to give the fans what they know they like. And we like Tatooine as fans.
I mean, we like Hoth, but no one lives on Hoth.
I'm so glad you said that, because that was the next word out of my mouth is, I love Hoth. Why can't we do a show on Hoth with like with Tauntauns and Wampas everywhere?
Yeah, but that's all that lives on Hoth. No one lives there. That's why they put the base there.
There's an exciting expedition. They uncover something in the ice. It might be like a shape-shifting kind of thing. Kurt Russell might be there. You could do it in Star Wars. Come on.
I was going to say Ice Rancor.
Ice Rancors. Okay, I'm down. Let's do it. Jar Jar Binks frozen in time.
And you have to watch this last episode of Boba Fett with the Rancor doing its whole Godzilla bit.
King Kong bit.
Why can't...
It's a King Kong
bit. King Kong, yeah. Why can't they do, like, make an extra large Rancor... But just do a complete King Kong spoof where it's a group of smugglers or something. They go to a planet and, oh no, it's a giant Rancor. And they just spoof King Kong for the entire movie, but it's in the Star Wars. It's a Star Wars story.
I mean, there have been episodes of the Clone Wars that kind of do that. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I would be 100% okay with it.
Yeah, I'm okay with more Star Wars.
Yeah. Yeah, more please. I'm fine. I am completely happy to have more Star Wars. I mean, it helps when it's good, and I think the Book of Boba Fett was good. I think people's expectations were just out of control for it.
Yeah, I mean, it's the Fett. Yeah. I understand the expectations were high, especially after that post-credit scene at the end of season two of Mando.
Yeah,
when he's shooting people and he's sitting on the throne, you're like, oh, is he going back to being bad?
Well, again, we just saw him like whoop some serious booty. In those episodes he was in. Yeah. And like you said, I mean, he is sort of powered down at the start of the show, and we don't get him back to full strength until the finale. And again, it's a great finale. I really enjoyed it. It was a little, again, if I were to critique it, it's like, yeah, it's a little bit like checking the boxes, but they set all this stuff up, so it works.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, all the stuff we did in the first bunch of episodes comes together right here, and it plays out. Perfect. I got no problems with any of that. And then you factor in Din and Grogu and Peli and the whole thing.
Yeah.
I'm all on board.
It all works. Yeah. It all works. Him getting a new ship and it's a Naboo fighter.
Mm-hmm.
Where, you know what? I'm sure it's going to turn out it's the actual one that Anakin flew. And
I mean, I've seen those rumors.
Oh, I haven't seen the rumors, but I'm sure it is. But
there's a people in there. They were trying to like match like the hull markings and stuff like that. I was like, oh boy, here we go.
They all look the same. I'm sure they all like. I'm sure that was a design feature of making the Naboo starfighter.
I want to shift gears on you a little bit here because I want to go back into the Mandalorian chunk of the episodes, but specifically episode 6, that first half when we're still following Din And he's meeting up with R2 and Ahsoka on the planet that will be the home to Luke's Jedi Academy, Luke's Jedi Temple. What did you think of the sequences between Luke and Ahsoka? I'm sort of curious how you felt about it.
I liked it. I wanted more of it, and I'm sure we'll get more in the Ahsoka show.
Yeah, I think I wanted it to be like the first time they would meet each other. I think that would be a really interesting.
Yeah, I think that's going to be the Ahsoka, and I think an Anakin Force Ghost is going to show up.
Yeah?
Yeah, and Hayden Christensen, and it's going to be incredible.
So I'm going to keep shifting gears on you here in this because I want to stay in this a little bit because, again, as usual, I have a very different perception of Ahsoka from a lot of people on the internet. I've said it on my show. You've heard me say it. I don't know if you agree or not. But apparently there's a whole like uprising that was going on the internet in recent weeks about Ahsoka. And there's a faction of Ahsoka fans who believe that she is still a Jedi.
No.
You answered my question. Because I was like, how do you feel about Ahsoka's role as a Jedi? Do you feel like she's a Jedi at all or no? And you just said it.
She's not a Jedi. She still was raised a certain way and still has beliefs.
Mm-hmm.
But she even says, I am not a Jedi.
Right. Thank you. Okay. So that leads me to my question. Don't you think, and again, I know she says in the episode, she's like, it's not my job to tell people what to do.
Yeah.
But she's seeing Luke going back to the ways of Yoda and Obi-Wan, ways in which that Ahsoka knows don't work out great for a lot of people. Don't you think maybe you interject and be like, hey, Luke, listen, let's try something different.
Because I think Papa Force Ghost is going to tell him that.
Right. But again, we know Luke's destiny, right? We know he's also ultimately not going to be a very good teacher. So I was a little dismayed that like Ahsoka seemed so gung-ho. She seemed so gung-ho for Luke to kind of bring back the Jedi in the same exact way in which she left it. And I was like, wait, Ahsoka's like the example that there is another way.
Well, did she find love and form attachments?
No, but she broke away from like the sort of dogmatic traditions.
She has to leave.
No, I mean she left on her own terms. Like she sort of realized like some of the hypocrisies, some of the other things that were going on, the influences, the way the dark side was sort of surrounding the Jedi. She's like, she saw these things and left, and was like, "There's a different way to do things," you know. And again, she still has a lot of that teaching in her. But in my opinion, she's a better Jedi because she left the Jedi Order.
Yeah.
So like, she's no Jedi. She says it in the shows.
Yeah. What if she started teaching her philosophy of the Jedi Order as something else? And she has disciples out there, and you're going to find out in the Ahsoka show.
I would absolutely love it.
Yeah. So would I. That sounds great.
It sounds amazing.
Do that. Make that happen. Yeah. Make that happen.
And again, I mean, you can go and look at her lightsabers, right? Like they're not bound by the Jedi colors because of her kind of neutral stance.
Yeah, they're white.
Yeah. And it's all reflective of her. So again, I was sort of a little dismayed that the first time we're seeing Luke and Ahsoka together, she's like, oh, this is a great idea. Go for it.
It's what he wants though.
So she's enabling.
Yeah, she's a big enabler. She's very supportive as long as you know what you want to do.
Right. And maybe she believes Luke can do it differently and do it better. Again, because the Order's been reduced to such small numbers. I hope these are things we get to explore more on the Ahsoka series because I'm very curious about a lot of it. There's so many things on the table that I would love to see them play with, and I hope they do.
Yeah, I really thought they were going to get rid of the no attachment thing.
Oh, for sure. I thought for sure that was the way.
I mean, this is the way, but it makes no sense to keep that. You know, don't have relationships because look how it worked out for Vader.
Right.
And it only worked out that way is because you let him buddy up with a Sith Lord.
You guys just let him keep going to meetings with Palpatine all the time. You're like, what the
hell? Yeah, like, you're like, we don't trust this Palpatine guy. You let them raise a slave army.
Oh.
And just let those poor guys get slaughtered by the A-load.
The A-load?
the A load, like me having to censor myself on MandoVision.
Yeah, I only bring these things up as kind of sort of like a commentary, because I want to talk about them more. I want to see them explored more. Like, more, give me more. That's all I'm really trying to say. I'm not trying to attack any of the choices or any of the decisions made. I just think it's so much of it's so interesting, and it's unfortunate that we are a little hamstrung because we know Luke's ultimate failures as a Jedi Master.
Yeah,
and that's a bummer. That bums me out. That makes me sad.
Oh, it's 1 second of indecision where you might murder his nephew.
The world looks so favorably on child murderers.
Yeah, like, ooh.
It's not a good look, Luke. It's not a good look. But again, the sequel trilogy is that's a whole other can of worms, and I don't want to go down that road.
Yeah.
All right, let's try to end things on a more upbeat, positive note and not think about the downfall of Luke Skywalker, because it just makes me sad.
I know. Maybe if he had found, like, Myra Jade out there somewhere, he had found love and had a son, things would have been different for him.
In another universe.
I know. I keep hoping she'll show up. I keep looking out for Talon card references.
Are you ready for the Star Wars multiverse?
I don't want a multiverse. I just want them to be in the main universe. I don't want it to be, some door they open and like 14 different Luke Skywalkers jump out. And they're like, this is the old beach dude, Luke Skywalker, and he has a Hawaiian shirt and a coconut drink and a lightsaber. Like, I don't want that guy out there.
That guy could party, though.
He's the fun Luke Skywalker. He's the fun, I'm not going to lie.
Yeah, that little umbrella and the coconut drink. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
Says
I'm not
going
to lie. He's the one you want to party with. But if you're going to defeat the Empire, you don't want that Luke with you.
No, I mean, the flip-flops alone will get in the way.
I know, like he's running down the Death Star and he's just shooting those things down the hallway. He's like, one sec.
Yeah, exactly. So this is sort of a loaded question, and it maybe is a bit unfair. But we're going to ask it anyways, because what we do on this show is we ask the hard questions.
All right. I'm ready for a hard-hitting question.
Boba Fett, a character you and I grew up with, and we love so much so, he's in the fiber of our being. We love him that much, right? We love the Fett. We are fans of the Fett as truly as it can be.
Yes.
But.
I don't like the but.
But. We've gotten a really, again, Boba Fett, not a Mandalorian. He said it as much as himself. So
true.
Before Boba came back, we were introduced to a new Mandalorian, one who embraced the Mandalorian culture, embraced the way, if you will. We get to meet Din Djarin. We can become attached to Din Djarin. Is Din Djarin now our favorite Mandalorian armored human being in the Star Wars galaxy? Ooh!
He's not there for me. My brother actually asked me this question during one of our conversations. He's not there yet. Mando's really close, though. I have room in my heart for both.
Oh, no, I'm not saying it's one or the other. Like, I don't deal in absolutes, okay? I'm just saying, you got to put them in, like, an order. I mean, it's okay to love all your children, but you can still have a favorite.
Yeah. Boba's still my favorite. Mm-hmm. And I can't believe I'm saying this, but there is another. Right. Hey, there is a rival coming up. And like if they do, like, I can't wait to see this next season. And if, Bo-Katan shows back up, which I expect she will. And the Armorer, I want to see pretty much all of it take place on Mandalore. Mm-hmm. And I want to see a bunch of Mandalorians. And I'll just fall in love all the time. I'll be like, oh, look at that guy's armor.
Yeah, it'd be great.
It's basically what I'm saying is I love anybody in Mandalorian armor.
More, please.
Yes, like, and you and I, we both love the Karen Travis books.
Oh, the so good.
They're amazing books. Oh, I love them. And all they were about Mandalorians. You know, bring Cal into this universe. Oh, like, have him show up somewhere with his dog.
That'd be great. Bring all those characters. I mean, more Republic Commandos are fine by me.
Yeah. Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, bring Cody, bring Rex. And I'm sure that Rex will show up. and Ahsoka.
I think it's only a matter of time before we see Rex somewhere. Yeah, agreed.
Yeah, like it's. I just want to know he's okay and alive after Empire, or you know, after the Empire fell.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't really have to do anything. Just have him call on camera and point at me and say, "I'm okay. I'm alive. I'm happy. Look, I got kids." And I'll be like, "Oh, Rex has kids. All right, don't hurt yourself. Go away. Like, you know, go farm or something.
Go sit down behind a Beskar wall so you're safe."
That's right.
No, I can't agree with you anymore. Din, if I were to have a favorite, Din and Boba are like neck and neck, and depending on the day, one might be a little bit ahead of the other.
Yeah.
I sort of maybe think, and again, like you said, playing speculation games for season 3 of The Mandalorian. I'm like, if they do some of the things I think they might do, like you said, go to Mandalore, get into some big beef with Bo-Katan over the Darksaber, Din could become my favorite pretty quick.
Yeah. What if Boba shows up and throws his support behind Din?
Right?
Oh.
Like, yeah, because, I mean, again.
As Mandalore. Also, start respecting Din Djarin. He has the Darksaber. He's Mandalore. I've read the books. Whoever has the sword is leader.
Right.
Show him some respect, please.
Well, and wouldn't it be nice, too, to have Boba kind of come back to the fold, come back to his father's heritage? Yeah. And you know, that, again, that was a big thing from the EU, but it'd be nice to kind of see that element kind of come back into it.
Right.
Like sort of like the wayward son returns home.
Right.
That would be awesome.
My brother and I were having a conversation about that, you know, everyone's turned on Boba. Him and Din are pinned down. And he's like, you know, no help's coming. I guess you're going to leave. And Din won't leave because this is the way.
Right.
And they have a moment. He's like, "You really believe that?" He's like, "Yeah." And Boba just says, "Good." And I wish so much that Boba just looked at him and said, "This is the way." Just to acknowledge, just like when Han Solo says, "Hey, Luke, may the Force be with you," before he leaves.
Mm-hmm.
Just, you know, just some connective tissue that would have cemented their friendship a little more and just make Star Wars fans like me go crazy. I mean, I still went crazy.
Right? It's such a great scene. Because
it is. And you know, can you imagine if Boba said, "This is the way," though?
Yeah. Oh, no, I agree. And I still think there's
he doesn't even have to mean it.
Well, again, like I'm so curious if you know, there's been no official announcement or anything, if there's going to be a season 2 of Book of Boba Fett. I mean, I'm curious where the show could go with Boba Fett now having like no rivals. Like
they didn't even know where to go at the end of the show. Because they say, like, what now, basically?
Yeah, I mean, you're not wrong. So, I mean, I'm curious to see what could happen next. I'm curious to explore more stuff on Tatooine, always. But, again, if you bring Boba into a more supporting role in Season 3 of Mandalorian, in a way, just like you said, or like we talked about, like, him coming back to Mandalorian, him sort of exploring his Mandalorian heritage, you know, and then throwing his support behind Din. Like, yeah, I mean, that's incredible. Like, I'd lose my mind.
Yeah, and you know, the Watch could show back up, or another faction of the Watch.
Oh, is
not the R, and they're like, "Oh, Darksaber's back in play."
Dude, there's so many.
You know,
elements.
Paz Vizsla told us about this.
There's so many elements ours. They could bring into play for Mandalore. Because I mean, you like, what if there's still a faction that like is loyal to Darth Maul for some reason? You know, they all have the horns on their helmets and stuff.
Well, that's what my brother was telling me. The armor has horns on their helmet,
right? And I was going to ask you about that next, actually, if you thought that was a connection to Darth Maul or not. Because it's not like what we saw on Clone Wars with his mm-hmm. Mandalorians. I mean, they were much more...
Well, it's been 5 years.
It wasn't as subtle as the Armorers right. were, if they're an homage to Darth Maul.
Rob, my brother, knew the name. Well, it's rumored on the internet that it's one of Maul's lieutenants. It's the Armorer. I hope so much that the Armorer was.
Well, Gar Saxon was killed, so.
No. It's. I would have to ask him. I can't. Or go back and listen to my own episode. It's in there. Koichi Pod. Go check it out. We just did one.
I don't know. I don't like to read rumors on the internet.
It's not reading. It's me telling you. Or my brother telling me.
Well, we can all go check that out soon, I guess.
And some people could still be loyal to Maul. Maybe he was really nice to them. Maybe like they skinned a knee and he had some Bacta spray and they're like, "You've made a friend for life."
Well, I mean, and then remember in Rebels there was like the faction that was like the Imperial Super Commandos.
Yeah.
So I mean, like, there's a lot you could get into with Mandalore.
And it's all cool.
It's all cool. It's all so cool.
Yeah, I mean, I remember playing the original Knights of the Old Republic game, and as soon as you get to Conquer Dawn, you don't get to Mandalore.
No.
You get to the moon that they stay on. And I remember running around to every dead Mandalorian I could find trying to put his armor on because I wanted to be a Mandalorian more than I wanted to be a Jedi.
Right.
They're like, you can have dual lightsaber. Don't care. Give me the Mando helmet. That's what I'm looking for the whole time.
Yeah. Yeah. But hey, Boba Fett had his helmet on a lot in this final episode, so I hope people were happy about that.
Yeah, I mean, I'm happy about it because I want to see Boba do the action. You do the action. That's
do the action.
Sentence.
Yeah.
You know, do action, fight, you know, shoot stuff. Like, I want to see Boba Fett be Boba Fett.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to see Boba Fett the negotiator or...
That's Obi-Wan's role.
Yeah. You know, boring conversation anyway. That's what I expected.
Well, that's sort of a funny part too, right? I mean, Boba Fett had like what, like 5 lines in 2 movies, and you know, now you're hearing him talk way too much.
Yeah, well, I don't even mind him.
No, I don't. No, again, I don't mind. Yeah. I just thought it was a funny.
Be a man of action. Yeah. Be a man of action.
Right.
You know, it's funny when Luke. You remember Cloud City? Luke's following you around, and Luke's like, "Oh, he doesn't see me," and then you just poke out of the hallway.
Blaster
like,
bolts.
Pop, I see you. Like, stop following me, kid.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, that's who Boba Fett should be.
No, and you know, I guess if that's one element you didn't see as well. It's sort of like the sort of cunning cleverness of Boba Fett. Like, you know, hiding in the Imperial trash to follow Han Solo, you know,
right.
Stuff like that.
Yeah. Well, I said on my show, during the Cad Bane standoff, he's going back and got another rocket.
Mm-hmm.
And they're about to have, you know, draw down on each other. Shoot that rocket at Cad Bane.
You're not wrong.
Like, shoot that rocket at him. It doesn't, you know, you could miss or shoot it behind him and the explosion pushes him forward and knocks him out.
So let me throw some at you here since we're kind of in speculation zone again. So what if we didn't massacre Boba's Tusken tribe, but at a certain point he decides it's time to leave. It's time to you know, reclaim his destiny or whatever like that. So when he rockets off to go get the Rancor, he also happens to come back with like an army of Tuskens.
What I thought was going to happen the entire time of the show, totally murder the Tuskens. I thought they were going to live at the palace. And they'd just be hanging out, feeding the Rancor stuff.
And dangling their kids in front of it.
Yeah, you know, they'd be playing their weird Tusken music in the background.
Why not?
Yeah, like, it wouldn't be the Max Rebo band, but...
Max Rebo, he knew something. He's still alive.
That's used to the internet conspiracy that he was in on it.
Oh yeah, he was either in on it or he was like taking a smoke break and got lucky.
Max Rebo needs a day off. He doesn't play every day. It's a special occasion, like, you know. It's he's famous in Tatooine. He was probably in Mos Eisley performing.
He's a legend.
Yeah, he's got to get around to all 3 major encampments. He can't just play Mos Espa all the time.
You think he's going to Anchorhead too?
I would imagine so.
I mean, why not? Have we never been to Anchorhead, have we?
I don't think so.
I don't think you've been to Anchorhead yet in anything.
Yeah. I wonder... mean, I'd buy the album Max Rebo live at Anchorhead.
You think it's a dump?
Definitely.
I think Anchorhead's a dump.
I mean, a lot of Tatooine's a dump. Like,
maybe it should be Max Rebo live at Tosche Station.
Yeah, that's a great album.
Yeah.
And I felt bad for the other musician.
What if they do a new version of Get Him to the Greek, but with Max Rebo?
I'd watch it. It'd be hilarious. You know, they could even give Russell Brand to voice Max Rebo.
Not the voice I had in mind, but okay.
Yeah, okay. How hilarious would that be? Because you're not expecting it. And then, you know, get Jonah Hill, put him in a Jedi robe.
No, he won't do it. He hates Star Wars. Jonah Hill can get out of here.
Wait, what?
Yeah.
Why?
Oh, apparently Leonardo DiCaprio tried to get him to watch The Mandalorian. He was like, yeah, whatever. He's like, Baby Yoda, whatever.
That really bummed me out, man.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Jonah Hill's not on my not cool list anymore. Because he's not down with the Star Wars.
I mean, is he one of those people who's like, oh, Star Wars for nerds? Like, he's too cool for Star Wars?
It kind of sounded like that, yeah. But I'm like, if Leo's into Star Wars, why are you too good for it?
Hey, Leo. What up, buddy?
Leo's got the Academy Awards. Come on.
Good job.
And Leo's got all the best memes on the internet now, right?
Yeah.
Like, how many memes of that of Leo from Once Upon a Time in Hollywood do you see with, like, the Mandalorian's head on it or whatever? Like, there's a million of them.
Oh, most of the, I see his Django Unchained.
The Django one's popular too, but the Once Upon a Time in Hollywood one has been taken off for this show in particular. The part where he's pointing at the TV set when he sees himself.
Yeah.
And they just put, like, you know, either Boba's head or Din Djarin's head on Leo's body.
You know? I haven't seen the movie yet. I need to see the movie.
What?
I'll go rent it tonight, okay? I'll watch it tonight.
Tom's getting upset.
He likes his chicken spicy.
And these pretzels make me thirsty. Holy smokes. All right, well, I think we're definitely going to have you come back on before Mando Season 3 so we can play wild speculation games after the trailer drops.
That's my favorite.
You know, I thought you liked Patriot games, but speculation games even more.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Speculation games greater than Patriot games. I mean, Patriot games are really good.
I mean, Harrison Ford, come on.
Yeah. But, you know, before he got real grumpy and started crashing planes all over the place.
any final thoughts about the Book of Boba Fett? Are you, I mean, overall, yay on the series, correct?
Yay. Love it.
Yeah. Big yay for me as well. And then as far as, like, continuing the story, would you do I know you're in, but would you be enthusiastic about a season two?
Absolutely. The only way I could have been negative if, like, they handed Boba his helmet and, like the swelling music came out and the character handed Boba his helmet and he took his helmet and then just chucked it behind him like it didn't matter. That would probably annoy me.
Okay, let me ask you one more question, because I remember this is something that Tamara Morrison apparently said in an interview recently, and I wanted your thoughts on it. He said that he would, if there were to be a season 2 of the Book of Boba Fett, that he would be A-okay with the sort of like a hunt for Mace Windu sort of storyline.
And 1,000%.
You don't think it's crazy?
Of course it is, but it's awesome. Why can't it be a young Boba Fett? They bring back the kid who played young Boba, because he's got to be, what, 30 now?
I mean, he'd be the right age, yeah.
Yeah, bring him, and he's going back. You know, it's, you know, you have older Boba, and it's more of like flashbacks to when he looked and tried to find Mace Windu.
Well, I mean,
that's when you find out Mace is still alive this whole time.
I mean, that's what they're sort of getting at, because, I mean, we've had young Boba go after Mace in Clone Wars.
Yeah.
But, and then, like, you know, by the time he comes to age, Mace is dead. I mean, how does Mace survive that? Let's kind of get into...
He force pushed with his one hand that he still had.
He was too busy yelling no all the way down.
I mean, people like to yell no in Star Wars. I mean, it's fun.
Listen, Palpatine had unlimited power. I don't think he can overcome that.
You know, a speeder came by, or a trash dump truck speeder thing came by. He fell in some trash bags.
And he just sat out the entire rebellion? Just was like, lay low.
They lost everything. He couldn't find Yoda. He got the beacon and it said, lay low. That beacon never changed.
Well, listen,
and then he's like, oh, shit, they blew up Alderaan. I am out.
I'm definitely okay with the Book of Boba Fett Season 2. I'm not crazy about, like, this sort of internet-driven, like, let's bring Mace Windu back to life scenario. I'm just like...
I'm fine if they do it, like I said, like it's flashbacks to a young Boba.
Sure, I could work with that.
And then at the end... He's not really alive. It's someone pretending to be Mace Windu.
I don't,
Boba still murders him.
I don't want Star Wars to get to the point where like death doesn't mean anything in Star Wars anymore.
Yeah, I agree. And Elsie has a great death.
It's a great death. His death is so pivotal to Anakin's turning. I feel like it would be undermining that quite a bit if you undid it.
And then there's, I mean, I get like. The aging technology doesn't cost anything. They do it to Luke Skywalker all the time so it's nothing.
I mean, by all means, bring Sam
back. And Sam
back.
Looks great anyway, don't even have to do that much.
Bring Sam back in another role. That's fine by me. I don't have a problem with that at all.
Bring him back as a Force ghost if you really want him to come back.
Or just a Jedi who looks a lot like Mace Windu or something, you know, along those lines. Like maybe Boba Fett starts going a little nutty. He's like, see, this guy looks like Mace Windu, but it's like, not, it can't be Mace Windu. That's crazy. So he's like hunting a guy who's not actually Mace Windu, but it's, I don't know. Like, there's all kinds of ways to play this out.
Yeah, like when he was high on the spice and the lizards in his brain, why can't he be seeing Mace Windu everywhere?
Yeah, there you go. But yeah, I mean, I like what we talked about with you know, Boba eventually going back to Mandalore, sort of embracing his heritage and, yeah, and potentially supporting Din's claim to bring Mandalore back together again.
Yeah, like his armor has that long chain code of who owned it, and they're all Mandalorians before him.
Mm-hmm.
And he could just be the world's oldest foundling.
I would, honestly, like, if they do like a second season, I mean, change the name to like Book of Mandalore and like just start going into like Mandalorian history. Yeah. How much fun would that be?
Oh, I would love that show immediately.
I mean, like there are so many questions about Mandalore still that we
need, yeah,
we
need to answer. And they've changed so much about it. And
yeah.
So anything you know about it, it's all new again, and it's going to be awesome.
Yeah, I agree. Well, listen. Oh, we got
Katie's not doing any. I was like, Katie's not doing anything. Bring her. She'll take a Star Wars check.
She's had a baby.
Oh, does she? Congratulations.
Yeah. She's being
a
mom right
now. Do you want to do more Star Wars, though? Like, you could bring the kid to work.
Yeah.
They got to take care, I'm sure.
Why not? Baby could sub in for Baby Yoda.
Awesome.
Stand in.
Yeah, as long as he has that little fat chin and does that hug, that got all in my emotions. And my wife was like, what is wrong with you? I was like, do you not see Grogu jump to hug the Mandalorian in the middle of a firefight?
Heck, wonderful. Yeah.
And also, my wife did say during that final climactic battle, she was like, okay, that's Boba Fett. Who is the guy in the silver Boba Fett costume? She has watched The Mandalorian with me. It was before Grogu showed up, so he wasn't... I'm assuming it's out of context. He didn't have the little green guy with him. So she didn't recognize him. She just thought he was another Mandalorian, I hope.
You know, I didn't bring up the Din and Grogu reunion stuff because I assume, you, just like me, you're in love with it. So like,
there's
nothing to talk about there. It's amazing. Yeah.
I mean, I was disappointed he didn't have his chainmail and lightsaber and doing some cool fighting stuff in the battle as well.
Well, maybe when Grogu chose the Beskar chainmail, Luke took the lightsaber back and then threw it over his shoulder.
Oh, maybe
that's where it started.
I think Grogu has it somewhere. He's just not proficient. Like, he's not ready to use it yet. He's not like Mando running in there with the darksaber. Well, he's like, I'm going to learn to use it.
Again, you know, we talk about the... I was trying to wrap the show up, but now I'm at a whole other tirade now. I mean, listen, they're telling us about Tar Vizsla, the Mandalorian Jedi Knight.
Mm-hmm.
Someone's going to bridge that again. Who's it going to be? I got an idea or two on that.
Grogu. Yeah.
I got an idea or two.
Put his little helmet on. It's going to be adorable.
I can't wait.
He might become my favorite Mandalorian.
I'm all in. It's like, yeah, I mean, there's going to be a character at some point who bridges that gap. Like, stop keeping these things separate. And I don't know if Favreau's like kind of like intentionally setting these things up. It's like, oh, no, these things can only be diametrically opposite until my story says otherwise. And then I'm bringing it all together because that's the way it should have been.
Oh, I can't wait. I'm excited for it.
I'm here for all of it.
Yeah, I'm here absolutely.
I won't even go down the road of some of the crazy internet speculation on the record with you. We can talk about that later. But
we will talk about it.
Oh my goodness. We will talk though, sir. And I'm so delighted you hung out with me today and broke down the show. Like I said, we'll have to have you back on for some more, especially when it comes to speculation time, because I know how much you like it.
I love speculation. I love making stuff up.
Regan, tell the good people where they can find you and your brothers at.
You can find us at CoisGPod on Instagram and Twitter, and CoisGPod.com. You can find out all the great stuff we're doing. We just released a recap of the Book of Boba Fett, the last three episodes in one big chunk, where we just speculate for like an hour, and it's fun.
And
I'm trying to think of the last movie we put out. I can't remember.
You'll find out that Regan has a thing about robots he's really into. And
I mean, keep it classy, San Diego.
Just prepare yourselves, folks. Check out the show. I recommend it, but prepare yourselves.
It's adult themed. I mean, if you'd like to know, like, former restaurants that used to be in Aspen Hill, Maryland,
if you are,
we'll talk about that occasionally.
If you are a former resident in the state of Maryland, you will really enjoy the show.
Yeah, yeah. If
you current residents are welcome as well. If you like Boba Fett, Boba Fett and Boba Tea, you'll like that show.
They go hand in hand. They're delicious.
All right, buddy. I will talk to you later. See ya.
All right, thanks. Aboosh. This is the way. That's how you do it, Mark.
Shots fired.
The way I see it, we have two choices. We wait until they get into position and launch a siege on their terms. Or we rush out there, catch them unaware, then we can escape to your ship at the palace.
I can't abandon Mos Espa. These people are counting on me.
Okay, then. We'll both die in the name of honor.
You sure you want to stay?
This is the way.
Hey, there you have it. That is our conversation with Regan from the Come On, It's So Good podcast. Thank you so much for him for coming on board and discussing our favorite Star Wars character. I was about to say something else about that. I was like, no, let's be perfectly honest. Our love of Boba Fett runs so deep. Han Solo, he's right there for me. But I think I still give it to our good friend Boba the Fett, because hey, who doesn't want to be a Mandalorian? I mean, my goodness, the armor is just so cool. The helmets are just so cool. Get a sweet T visor. Come on, all about it. One thing I guess I just want to kind of like underline. What we were trying to do with this, what we're trying to say is like, you know, because this series has been heavily criticized for some of the choices made, some of the weird actions. I didn't even bring up with Regan the oft-mocked spin maneuver of SCAD in that final episode. Does it really do anything? Does it really mean anything? Does it serve any particular purpose? No, of course it didn't. I mean, just like, whatever. Like, it's a young kid. And maybe he thought it was cool. It's like when holding your gun sideways, right? It's just like it's like style points, I suppose. I don't think it's stylish, but apparently he does. So like, why bring that stuff up? Again, this is a show that has been widely criticized and critiqued, and I think Ray and I are both on the same page that while some of the criticisms are fair, it's not the point. Like, we just are enjoying this. Because we're enjoying this, like, it's okay to like something for its entertainment factor, right? If you're entertained, then that's really what we're trying to say is the bottom line here. And if you didn't like it, that's completely your prerogative, and you're a-okay. And like I said, I found a very few arguments against the show that I'm like, well, okay, I mean, I see where you're coming from. You know, when people want to knock the show and they give me their well thought out reasons, I'm like, okay, I can't argue with any of that. That's just your take on it, and if you want to hold the show to that sort of level, I guess that's okay. It's totally fine. Again, it's your complete prerogative. I just think that for a lot of us Star Wars fans, and I hold myself in this group as well, sometimes we let our expectations get the better of us, and we're waiting for something spectacular and grandiose, and that's not always going to be what happens. That's not always the case here. We have to modify our expectations to be more reasonable. I mean, it's still a show. It's still something with a budget and constraints. It's not going to the box office to make untowards millions of dollars, in a 48-hour period. You know, this is, I don't know the economics of the subscriber services. I assume that Disney's doing quite well with all of these things, and then all the different other revenue streams they have coming into Disney via the rides and the parks and all their other movies and stuff like that. So I don't know how the economics all breaks down, but I know that when you have a movie, I mean, you make hundreds of millions of dollars in like the first couple of weeks, and that may be a bigger payoff than a streaming service. I mean I don't know the economics are beyond my scope, but these things have limitations is really what I'm trying to say. And one of the reasons why the Clone Wars really grew on me and Star Wars Rebels is because it was animated, you could get away with a lot more stuff. You could do a lot more things. And so we're kind of having a live action show is so fantastic and so amazing, but you have to kind of a modify, right? Like you can't go about things in maybe the same way you would when you have like 100,000 different visual effects on the screen in an animated series or in a movie. You have to kind of downsize a little bit. That's what The Mandalorian is, right? The Mandalorian and Book of Boba Fett, a bit more ground level, right? And not the grandiose space opera Star Wars that we're used to. It's smaller in scope. But that final episode of Book of Boba Fett, I thought, had a very cinematic feel to it. They really did try to pull out all the stops, you know, with Boba riding the Boba riding a Rancor. And shots of the Rancor scaling the towers in Mos Espa. Things like that. I mean, they did a lot in that final episode. And it was, yes, I still say, yeah, they was kind of like checking the boxes because like they were like bringing all the elements they set up earlier in the season. And it's like, okay, now we got this and this and this and this. And now we bring it all together and we make spectacle with it, right? And they did. And I think that's what Ray and I were trying to emphasize, right? The show was really enjoyable, really fun. Is it going to change your fundamental understanding of Boba Fett? Is it going to change your fundamental understanding of crime on Tatooine? No, there's still a lot of questions. You know, there's story points that are still a bit ambiguous. I still don't completely understand Boba Fett's motivation. I still don't completely understand Boba Fett's connection to Tatooine, unless it's something, you know, more that happened with his time with the Tuskens. And that's one reason why I wanted to talk to Regan about that timeline and see if they had, you know, if he had any thoughts on how much time he really spent with the Tuskens, learning their ways and learning more about Tatooine. And perhaps that's where this connection to the planet kind of comes from. Again, some of the story points are a little vague, a little ambiguous, and we just have to go with it. We have to go along for the ride, and maybe we'll get some further exploration of it down the road, and we'll have to take our chances with that, you know. And I know I talked about it again with Regan because we're in the same age bracket. We grew up reading the old EU canon stuff, and I mean I remember the first time I've talked about it on the show when they first brought Boba Fett back into play, right, in the Dark Empire comic book series, when Han and Leia and everyone's on Nar Shada, and then all of a sudden Boba and some bounty hunters show up, guns ablazing at him, right? And you're like, oh my God, Boba Fett escaped from the Sarlacc pit. Incredible. Incredible. And then Boba Fett was sort of stayed in the comic books for a long time, right? They didn't get into the novels with Boba Fett for a little while. Like some of the anthology series had some Boba Fett stuff, like Tales from Jabba's Palace, and which had like his original escape from the Sarlacc. But a lot of the books, a lot of the novels of the EU stayed away from him. You know, Timothy Zahn didn't do anything with him. He wasn't in anything, really. I mean, I think the next time he popped up in one of the novels was towards the tail end of the Uzan Vong War, when Han Solo once again sees who he thinks is, a figure in Mandalorian armor leading a group of Mandalorian commandos against the Uzan Vong in a space station. And the guy kind of like winks at Han, and Han's like, Boba Fett? ? And you're like, wait, what? And it's one of those things that just sort of fires the imagination. And then shortly after that, we started spending more time with Boba Fett, you know, 20 plus years after Return of the Jedi, as he sort of is like the wayward son coming home to Mandalore. And a lot of that had to do with Karen Travis getting involved and wanting to tell the story of these clone soldiers and kind of creating this beautiful tapestry for Mandalore. That would be controversially done away with when Star Wars The Clone Wars was coming together, and Lucas and Dave Filoni had their own plans for Mandalore and what they wanted to do. And there was some other stuff going on too. Like there was some financial things with Karen Travis and a lot of stuff. So she didn't get to finish her stories, which was a shame because they were spectacular. But they sort of, I think for Regan and I and a lot of people in our age bracket who grew up reading those, they kind of kept our expectations of that character higher than maybe is reasonable. And you know, again, when you wipe the slate clean, it's one thing to say, yeah, the slate's clean now. We can do whatever we want because we just cleared the decks of continuity. People like me still have it in the back of our brains. And even though we know it doesn't count anymore, you still kind of think about these things as you're seeing the new adventures of this character. You're like, oh, man, they're doing this a lot differently than I thought they would have. And again, managing expectations is really what it's all about. And with Star Wars, something that's so beloved by so many people, It's easy to let our expectations get away from us and you know, run rampant with speculation. Regan talked about how much he loved speculation. I sort of try to be in the middle with my speculation, but it's just fun because it's Star Wars and we love talking about Star Wars. And the other element I want to talk about was Ahsoka too. We got into that with Regan a little bit, so I was excited to talk about Ahsoka and sort of being the ideal Jedi by not being a Jedi. You know, not following the pragmatic ideologies of the Jedi, those dogmatic teachings of the Jedi that we know are flawed, and that we've seen bring down the Jedi Order not once but twice with Luke in the sequel trilogy. You know, his temple fails because he tries to bring back the same exact teachings of his former masters, and it doesn't go well. Also, the attempted murder of a student, not a good look if you're still recruiting people. You know, you don't want to go to a recruit's house and be like, yes, I did attempt to murder a student. Sorry about it. Won't happen again. It's a hard sell. that is a strange reference metaphor. Sorry. You have to be in the college sports to really appreciate that one. So, but yeah, this sort of thing with Ahsoka that. Again, it's a lot of it's internet based, and I don't know how you all feel about it. We can agree to disagree. If you still think that Ahsoka is a Jedi, then that's your right, and that's all good. But I think because of her breaking from the Order and her willingness to kind of forge her own path with the Jedi teachings in mind, but more relying on her own moral compass, makes her a better Jedi than the Jedi that fell in Order 66. Sue me. Sorry, I'm saying it. I think Ahsoka is the next level. So, again, she's not one to tell Luke what to do. She says that in the episode. But I do feel like her attempting to caution Luke might have gone a long ways to helping Luke understand the failings of his masters. But that's for another day. And that could be something that's later explored on the Ahsoka show. I mean, we've seen the willingness to go and have digitized de-aged Luke in these shows for an episode or two. And so perhaps we can explore that more. And I would really love to see the initial meeting of the two characters, of Luke and Ahsoka meeting each other for the first time. And then Ahsoka, you know, telling Luke about his father. Like, that would be just so wonderful to see on a Star Wars show. I would love it so, so much. And yeah, I think that's it. I think I'm going to wrap it up right there. Those are sort of the things I wanted to underline coming out of the conversation. But again, we enjoyed this show. I will be watching the Book of Boba Fett again. It's an enjoyable show. Is it deep? Is it changing your meaning of Star Wars? Is it causing you to re-examine the way you looked at Star Wars? No, it's not doing any of those things. You know, and I've said it before. Like, I would love to have like a Game of Thrones style show about Mandalore and the different factions on Mandalore and the various clans of the Mandalorians, and I, you know, you may get something like that, but because, you know, Disney's not HBO, it's not going to be Game of Thrones. It's not going to be a lot of backstabbing and blood and guts and you know, political upheaval and turmoil. It's going to be kind of all ages friendly, and that's something we have to deal with. You know, are there going to be more darker aspects of Star Wars to explore? I think there will be. I'm very curious to see how the tone of Andor is when we move into that series. Even the tone of Kenobi, because we are in the period of the Empire, right? And one of my favorite elements of Rogue One is sort of feeling the weight of the Imperial boot on the galaxy. So I hope that Andor has that feel to it. I hope that Kenobi has that tone to it, that you know, the galaxy is currently being oppressed, and in Andor's case, he's rebelling against it. In Obi-Wan's case, he's hiding from it, attempting to subvert it by keeping his eye on a child who may rise up against it one day. We'll see how dark they're willing to go. That's sort of a question we've had about Disney Star Wars for a little while now. They showed a propensity for some darkness in Rogue One, but Rogue One was a long time ago now at this point, we'll just have to see what Disney's willing to do, especially on a streaming service that I think by its nature is more all ages friendly than going to the cinema, because, you know, a movie has a rating on it, right? And you can put up a little screener at the beginning of your show, like, hey, this might be a little bit more adult theme, but people are still going to go into it with the perception that it's Star Wars, so it's okay for my kid. And generally that should be correct, because Star Wars should have an all ages feel to it in a sense. So again, it's a difficult... Disney has a hard job. They have a lot of masters to please. Lucasfilm in the same vein. A lot of different masters to please. And I think we have to manage our expectations. I guess that's really what I'm trying to highlight here. So enjoy the show for what it is. And if you don't, that's okay. Because there'll be another show in a few months, and maybe that one's more your cup of tea. And that's the good part about Star Wars, right? There's always going to be something next. There's going to be something to look forward to. If this one didn't work for you, there will be something else. And that's okay. That's the way it works. I mean, Marvel is kind of the same way too, right? You know, they do. They have the straightforward superhero stuff. They have sci-fi stuff. They have space stuff. They have magic stuff. You know, there's lots of different facets to the Marvel Universe. And I think Star Wars will eventually get to that point, too, where there's facets that maybe connect with you more than other ways, more than other aspects of it, right? We'll see. We will see. Anyways, I'm just rambling at this point. I could just keep going forever and ever and ever because it's Star Wars. And I love to talk about it so much. Anyways, I hope you all had a good time with this dissection, this after-action report on the Book of Boba Fett. I can't wait to watch it again. I'm really excited to watch it again. Maybe see some more nuance in the show that I missed the first couple times around. Maybe now that I'm not worried about writing reviews and doing podcasts about the episodes, I can kind of let it sink into a little bit of a deeper level. We'll see, though. All right. So thanks again to Regan from Come On It's Still Good. You know all the links. He gave them all out to us, and I'll be sure to put a link up in the show notes for their show as well. Those are good guys. They are my good friends. I've known them for so long, and they are near and dear to my heart. So if you enjoy talking about retro movies, go check out their podcast because they are super fun. All right, let's get out of here. Let's get ready. Next week, I think this will be the only show of the week, barring any breaking news. In the Star Wars world, in the Star Wars galaxy. But then Monday we come back and we will kick off season 4 of Star Wars The Clone Wars, and I cannot wait. It's going to be really, really exciting. All right, let's get out of here. Wait a second. Hold on. I'm still not used to doing this yet. I have to thank the official MandoVision Maniacs, which you can become over at patreon.com/MandoVision. You can join the Maniacs and gain access to sweet bonus content. Thank you to our current Patreons, the Aspenil Chody, The Batman Abejo, Jeff Nail, Jeff Cosing, The Ringing Ear, a great podcast. Check them out. They're all about music. Thanks to Evil Circle, the evilest of all circles, the Squidmaster General, Brian Broussard, the New Jersey Devil, Mark Wegemer, our very own Joker and Harley Quinn, Brian and Krista of Pariah Brewing Company here in San Diego and now Baltimore, Maryland, the Beer Hop Brigadier General, Jesus Beer Hops, the Silent Assassin, He Who Shall Not Be Named, and Syndicate Ram, he's the co-host of Come On, It's So Good. You might have just heard him. Spoilers, his alias is ruined. It's over. Hey, membership has its privileges, right? That's what they tell me. All right, let's get out of here. I'm excited. We'll talk very, very soon. So much coming up on our Star Wars plates this year. It's going to be awesome, and we're here with you every step of the way. And remember, this podcast only ends one way. This is the way.
This is the way.
This is the way.
This is the way.
I would like to see the baby.